Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Town of Austining special meeting and work session for April 4th. Please rise and join me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Councilwoman DeTori?
Present.
Councilwoman Jeffrey?
Present.
Councilman Wilcher?
Present.
And Supervisor Levenberg?
Here.
Okay, so tonight we are holding a short special meeting to take care of some pressing business before we move into our work session. First up is opening a public hearing on what is now proposed local law number 4 of 2017, but will become local law number 3 of 2017. This is to extend the development moratorium by another month. The moratorium has been in effect since June of 2016, and the plan was to lift it concurrent with passing a change to our zoning law. However, we have received a lot of public feedback, and while we continue to collect it and incorporate it into the law itself, we need to maintain the moratorium until we actually finish deliberating and are ready to vote and vote on the law. The end is in sight, and we appreciate everyone's patience as we move towards adopting the amendments to the zoning code. Is there anyone here to address the board on this issue?
Do we have to make a motion to open it? No. No.
No. I think can we have a motion to close this public hearing?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? All right. And since we didn't have any objections or questions on this local law, I would like to suggest that we adopt the law this evening to avoid a lapse in the moratorium, which is set to expire this Friday. Council, do you have any objection to this?
No.
All right. So we will vote on this in the resolution portion of the meeting. I have some quick announcements to share tonight, the first of which is that, due to the weather, the JCYS parade that had been scheduled for last Saturday, April 1st, was postponed and will instead be happening this upcoming Saturday, April 8th. Lineup is at 8 a.m. and step-off is at 8:30 a.m., a little different from what the original plan was because there are so many other things happening, and it's at Roosevelt School, same, which is a bit earlier than usual, as I mentioned. I look forward to seeing everyone at the parade before we head over to the Eggs Extravaganza, which starts at Ryder Park at 10 a.m. and then again at Nelson City Park at noon. Eggs Extravaganza is a rain or shine event, so if we have any rainy weather or poor field conditions, it will be moved indoors to the community center. If you have questions about the weather and want to know where it's going to be, you may give the recreation desk a call on Friday for the most current information. And the number there is 941-3189. Then I have a whole lot of other stuff to talk about. The Austining Documentary and Discussion Series to tie in with upcoming Earth Day is going to be featuring a Fierce Green Fire, the first big picture exploration of the environmental movement, grassroots and global activism spanning 50 years from conservation to climate change. And that will be Thursday, April 20th, 6:30 p.m. at the Austining Public Library's Boudars Theater, 53 Croton Avenue. We have Earth Day celebration coming up sponsored by Green Austining, and it's our seventh annual, and also the town and village are also co-sponsors of this. That'll be at Lewis Engel Waterfront Park, starting at 11 a.m. and going until 4 p.m. And the focus this year is on food sustainability. So I think that's what it's called. I'm just trying to see. Food sustainability themed celebration of the 47th annual Earth Day. So we're looking forward to that. And that's rain or shine again. If you need more information about that event, you can go to greenaustining.org. Other events. Just wanted to bring everybody's attention to the Spring Summer 2017 Recreation Program brochure, which is now available. You can find it on the villageofaustining.org website, and it's time to sign up for all these great programs. Of course, I want to bring your attention to some new programming, which is tied into the Cedar Lane Arts Center at Cedar Lane Park, there will be ceramics classes available for adults and children, so please check it out. And we hope we get lots of people to sign up because they're going to be great programs. There's an Immigration Rights and Services for Providers training on April 5th at 8:30 a.m. at Austin Public Library. I will be there. I hope others will also join me there, especially if you work for an organization where it might be particularly pertinent that you have this information to help people out. Also on Wednesday, April 5th at 7:30 p.m. at Shattamuck Yacht Club, Ferry Sloops has a spring lecture series on Hudson Valley ruins, and that sounds like it's going to be great. April 8th at 7:30 p.m. Is Austin's Second Saturday Jazz. John Codman has taken the lead on this effort, and you can reach him at john@johncodman.com. He's one of the Village of Austin trustees, and his phone number is 917-488-7187. If you are interested in going to that event, that's at the Austin Elks Lodge, again, April 8th at 7:30 p.m. Did the Austin documentary and discussion series already. We have live blues coming to Austin. The Blue Rays, also at Austin Elks Lodge on April 22nd, and also John Codman, same information as before. We have the Gravestone Cleaning and Restoration Workshop at sponsored by the Austin Historic Cemeteries Conservancy, and that's the 2017 kickoff of that effort. I will be there bright and early before we get started with our Earth Day celebration on Saturday, April 22nd, 9 a.m. to noon. 104 Havel Street at Dale Cemetery, and they will supply all the materials. And you can, if you're a student, you can get community service credit. You're going to follow the yellow arrows from the cemetery entrance on Havel Street to the workshop, and then snacks and water will be provided. It's lots of fun, and I encourage you to attend that. And following that, on April 23rd, there's a Happy Birthday New York celebration that has been organized by Miguel Hernandez. That's going to be taking place at Market Square at the corner of Main and Spring Streets in downtown Austin, April 23rd at 2 p.m. Our own DJ Johnny G will be blasting your favorite all-time New York-themed songs, and the stirring finale of the 1812 Overture. Okay, sorry about that. No offense to the composer. So I'm forgetting that wrong. The 1812 Overture. And then I think that I've gone out far enough for lots of great events coming up, as you can see. Don't miss them. And if you haven't, you can sign up for information from the Village of Austin. Sends out a web blast with all of that stuff on it. So don't miss that. And then, of course, I want to be sure to invite everyone to the grand reopening of what was once the Shine House, and will now be known as the Cedar Lane Art Center on the afternoon of Friday, April 21st. Our parks crew has been hard at work, as we have discussed many, many meetings, for several years to bring this project online, and we look forward to celebrating with you. The invitation's on the town website, so please be sure to RSVP to Victoria in my office by email at V, as in Victoria, Caffarelli, C-A-F-A-R-E-L-L-I, at townofaustin.com. Or give us a call at 762-6001. Since I was so long-winded, does anybody have anything to add to the announcements?
What time is the grand opening for the Cedar Lane Arts?
So it's 4:00 is a program for children. They're going to have a project to work on, and then we've invited people for a tour at 5:30. We're going to have a ribbon cutting at 6:00. And then there will be an event for adults, a pottery event, and a demonstration at 6:30. Okay? So it's approximately from 4 till about 7:30 all in, if you want to be there for the whole event. Okay? And I did not mention the time, so thank you for reminding me about that. Okay, so hearing no more announcements, we have a departmental report this evening from our own Kathy Asaro, who's our Senior Nutrition Program Manager. And Kathy, you want to join us and tell us what's been going on with your seniors lately? Our seniors, all of the seniors. Yes.
Our seniors are fine.
Great. Welcome.
Thank you. We finally got our bus back.
Yay. Which is,
the seniors are happy. The staff is happy. It makes it a lot easier for our job, you know, to get the seniors around. It was out of commission since last July. We got it back the end of February.
It had a little problem, and it took a very long time to get the correct parts to fix it, and it was very tough on the program.
It was. It was crazy busy without the bus.
Especially on.
We have a van and two transits. And even to get one of the cars in for, you know, an oil change or anything like that was next to impossible.
Right.
I mean, unless Gary did it overnight, you know, work late. Sometimes he did just to do it. But he's awesome. Anyway, that's good. That's back. We're taking them to Walmart this Friday. So they're happy about that. They can go on a trip, and the rest of our vans can pick the seniors up for lunch, those that are not going. In May, we're invited to Westchester Restorative Nursing Facility up in Mohegan Lake for a free lunch. So we have the bus, and we'll probably borrow the other bus from Chris just to get, because we can invite 50 seniors. So some of them drive, some of them depend on us, you know, but we have other vehicles, but gets kind of hairy when they all want to go and we don't have enough vehicles. So that's coming up. Our exercise classes are back free of charge through Mainstream, Westchester Community College. 16 weeks starting middle of April. April 18th it starts. We have a yoga, chair yoga class, and an exercise class with exercise bands, which they love both classes, and both teachers are awesome.
So do you get a lot of
at least 20 or more seniors per class. But during the summer, we have the camps down at the community center, so we kind of lose our space in the art room where we have the class, so it gets kind of tight in the dining room. They have to do it back there, the class, so. But it works out. We'll figure it out. You know, they like the class. I mean, and we'll get more seniors to do chair yoga while they're sitting there doing their puzzles.
Yeah.
So that's our next challenge. But and we're working on a new county reporting system, PeerPlace. So it's getting interesting. But yeah.
Then we have question mark. Going to happen at the federal level, that's going to impact.
Yeah. Well, I just got contract. They're not mailing the contracts anymore. They're emailing them. So I have to print them, fill them in, send them to you. You know, so I have to fill in all the numbers, and it's been busy, real busy, between the new programming and the contracts and everything else that's going on down there, and helping seniors.
Yeah.
So we're busy.
We love it. They went to the senior prom last.
Senior prom. They loved the senior prom. They did sister act first at the high school in the auditorium, and then they went and had their dinner. Everyone I talked to had a good time. They
I
had
heard
a real
good
time
from that one. From some of the seniors.
Yeah, had a really good
time. Even ones who never go out. So.
Yeah.
They did good with that.
Yeah, they do.
They love that.
They get there.
Get to see a free show. Great.
Yeah. Yeah.
Get to be at the high school, and it's really nice. It's like a good
I love it.
Relationship building for everybody.
It is. It's good. Mm-hmm. It's good for them to get out, too.
Yep.
So that's the main objective, to get people out and into the senior center to have fun, to be with people.
Absolutely.
Don't be, you know, sitting home.
Yeah.
I have a question. When I was at the Association of Towns meeting, I saw that they had a lot of programs geared towards seniors about how to avoid the scams and the phone calls. Have you brought them in? It looked like the program, they would come in for free.
We had victim assistance come in. They spoke to the seniors about that.
About all the up-and-coming IRS and
all
the
scams and all that, yeah.
Okay, I think that's really worthwhile to
They come in every once in a while. Every couple of months we have them in talking to the seniors.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
I get those phone calls all the time.
I do too.
Yeah.
Seems they owe the IRS.
No, it's not terrible. There's a Cletus one where you just say yes or yes when they catch you and record your voice and then use it? That's
Yeah, you got to be careful. Really do.
All right.
And that's about
any
it.
Any other questions
for now?
Kathy?
No, I love it. We love it. It's great. You've been there for
30 years.
Yeah.
I know.
30 years, so, you know.
So I like my job.
Yeah, just a little bit. So that's, I mean, how much better does that get? It's when you have somebody who's been there and knows what to do and calls the call program. Are you okay?
I do that every morning.
Yeah. It's just a great, 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 great program. So I think we're proud to have it in the town for all of our seniors. And so thank you for everything you do.
Thank you.
You're very appreciative. And I know that I think I was just there. I was not there. I was there around Valentine's Day probably. That might have been the last time that I visited. And also I tried to talk to the seniors a little bit about the Austin Basics program to see if we could encourage them to talk to their children and grandchildren about reading to the kids when they're very little and walking around with them and pointing things out in the supermarkets and just talking and singing and counting and pointing and all the things that it really helps to do with the little ones. Because we know that, a lot of times grandparents are often caretakers. And if they're not primary, they're secondary, and they're, the ones who can really encourage their children to be great parents. So we hope that they'll help us with that effort and continue to be part of our community in that way and make sure that kids are coming to school ready to learn.
We cut you off by any means?
No.
Oh, I thought you may not have been finished.
No, I'm done. I was listening. I'm listening.
That's why I asked for any questions. Does anybody else have any questions?
Keep up the good work.
Yeah, doing a great job, and we really appreciate it. And we love our seniors, and we love that you take such good care of them. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
What should I say? You want to hang out?
Feel free.
No. We want you to hang out.
We like company.
Yeah, we do. All
right, so public comment on agenda items. Is that what we're up to? Okay.
Do we have any public comment on any agenda items this evening? Okay, seeing none, we will move into board resolutions.
Sorry, because the agenda now includes the adoption of the local law for the moratorium, I guess that should just be made known because it wasn't on the agenda. So if anyone has comments on that either.
Okay. Contract Tyler Technologies. Resolved that the town board of the town of Ossining hereby authorizes the supervisor to sign an agreement with Tyler Technologies with offices at 1 Tyler Way, Moraine, Ohio, for the 2017 year to provide support services to assessment staff in connection with a townwide revaluation project at a cost not to exceed $8,000 and upon approval by council to the town as to form.
Do I have a motion?
So moved. Second.
All right. So this first one was late breaking. It just came to us today. It'll allow us to authorize me to sign a contract with Tyler Technologies for 2017. This was something that was budgeted for in our 2017 operating budget. It will enable our assessor and his staff to keep the role balanced and at 100% value. The good news is that we had budgeted $10,000 for the expense, but the contract amount will not exceed $8,000. So we will still be under what we had anticipated the budget. So do I have any questions, discussion? Okay.
Are we going to have this every year?
This is actually something that's planned to be every year because they're helping keep the role up to full value by evaluating what the sales are. And I think they have a tool that Fernando uses that helps them do that. So we're paying them for, I think, for software and for the ability to keep the role up to speed.
Okay, and they work in conjunction with the Long Island firm. Didn't we have?
We don't need them anymore. That was a,
Oh, okay. So this is not, we don't have Haberman. We have this.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, that was more for the when we were doing the home going into the homes and making sure that all of that information was done correctly.
Okay.
You were like. something like that. Anyway, so we don't have Haberman this year.
Okay.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Whereas the town board of the town of Austining has been considering the adoption of a proposed local law entitled Amendment to Extend Interim Development Moratorium Within the Unincorporated Town of Austining, which means to impose a temporary moratorium on development within the town of Austining to allow for a planning and zoning analysis consistent with the town's comprehensive plan. And whereas, in accordance with New York State law, and after having provided all requisite notice thereunder, the town board conducted a public hearing on introductory local law number 3 of 2017, entitled Amendment to Extend Interim Development Moratorium Within the Unincorporated Town of Austining, on April 4th, 2017, at 7:30 p.m. at 16 Croton Avenue, Austining, New York, during which the public had the opportunity to be heard on such proposed local law. And whereas the proposed local law is a Type 2 action and does not require environmental review, now, therefore, be it resolved that the town board of the town of Austining hereby adopts local law number 3 of 2017, entitled Amendment to Extend Interim Development Moratorium Within the Unincorporated Town of Austining, with such adoption to take effect as set forth in said local law and as otherwise required by law. And be it further resolved that the town board directs said local law number 3 of 2017 to be filed and or distributed in accordance with applicable law.
Okay. Do I do the motion? Mm-hmm. Okay. I just want to make sure. Do I have a motion?
Second.
And this is a roll call vote. Councilwoman DeTore. Councilwoman Jeffrey.
Aye.
Councilman Wiltshire.
Aye.
Councilwoman Feldman.
Aye.
And Supervisor Levenberg.
Aye.
Okay, thank you.
All right, and now we are going to, I think, move in. Yeah, close the. We're done.
There's no P.
Close the special. Meetings. Do I have a motion to adjourn into work session?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstention. Okay. So we have three special presentations tonight. The plan was originally to have our judges make a presentation about the operations of the Austining Town Court, but unfortunately, they needed to reschedule. Fortunately for us, our town prosecutor, Benjamin Levitt, was available, and we asked him to come speak to the board about an initiative he's been working on behind the scenes for some time now that will hopefully help our town court to be more efficient and help improve outcomes for our residents. Ben, would you please join us?
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Good evening, council members, supervisor, esteemed council, budget officer. I am not a judge, so even though you were slated to have, I think, more esteemed presenters, I do thank you guys for your time. It was a little bit last minute, so I'm going to apologize if I'm not as organized as I might have been otherwise, but I did want to take this opportunity to provide some information about an exciting program that we are in the process of and very close to implementing in the vehicle and traffic prosecution portion of the town court. And so just as a sort of background matter, the vehicle and traffic calendar is basically made up of two types of offenses. One are moving violations, one are non-moving violations. The non-moving violations are usually equipment violations. Those don't carry any points on people's license. They are usually resolved by the person fixing whatever it is. If it's tints on the windows, they provide proof that they've removed the tints, they've got their car inspected, whatever it is. The other category of offenses is moving offenses. Those are speeding, stoplights. I see some council members rolling their eyes. They might be personally familiar with these kinds of offenses. These are the majority of the traffic calendar and are at this point resolved by during a pretrial conference. I will meet with individual motorists who are charged with offenses and engage in a negotiation process with them to see if we can dispose of their case. Depending on the offense, depending on their driving record, offers of reductions are made to lesser point offenses, no point offenses, and fines. Those are currently how the cases are resolved. In certain cases, mostly at this point with younger drivers, I have been, and it's my understanding this has been the practice of the prosecutor prior to me, with younger drivers, offering them the opportunity to take a defensive driver class in order to have their case dismissed, believing that the education that they'll get will be a benefit not only to them, but also to the community in providing assurances of continued safe driving, that sort of thing. The traffic diversion program that I first came up with and have been talking to Chief Sylvester about implementing came to my attention because several upstate counties have these traffic diversion programs. And I looked at them and was really struck by the power of these programs to address all of the concerns that unsafe driving, driving infractions cause to a community, and really seemed to me to provide the best approach to providing I like to call it a win-win-win, but really addressing every single stakeholder in the process and providing a positive outcome for them. And so the idea of the traffic diversion program is that rather than having a point disposition and pay a fine, the motorist will agree to enter the diversion program by which they will, and I should just back up, and there are certain offenses that are eligible and certain offenses that aren't eligible. I don't want to get too lost in the weeds on the particulars of the program at this point, but I do want to give you guys assurances that the more serious offenses, driving 30 miles an hour over the speed limit, reckless driving, those sorts of things are not eligible offenses for the traffic diversion program. So we are sort of talking about the run-of-the-mill speeding offenses, running red lights, that sort of thing. The essentials of the program is that a potential participant will be given the opportunity to take a defensive driver class. They will be screened for eligibility by the police. So it will be people who do not have any traffic convictions within a 12-month period leading up to their time in court. They will not be able to have participated in the diversion program in the 6 months leading up, so they can't come in and be repeat offenders. That's one of the things that would exclude someone from the program. Once they're screened for eligibility, they will be offered entry into the program. They will pay a application fee in an amount that generally tracks what the average fines are for the various offenses at this point in time. They'll pay that application fee. They will provide proof that they have completed the program. At that point, I would recommend that the court dismiss their case. And so they will be diverted away from the regular course of getting points on their license, having their insurance go up, and that sort of thing, being given the opportunity to have their case dismissed with no points, no fines. Even though they are paying an application fee, there would be no fines. Now, as I said, you know, this is really a win-win-win. And so what we do with this program is we promote safe driving. So we're having offenders, rather than just come in, pay a fine, have points on their license, and say, have a merry day and let DMV deal with them, we're ensuring that they receive an education component as part of their court experience. So they go forward with the 5-hour safety course, whatever it is. And these courses are approved by the DMV. They can be taken online. They can be taken in bricks and mortar stores, what have you. Because they're getting educated, we're also reducing the chance of reoffending. And so rather than saying, well, you get a smack on the wrist and it may hurt a little bit, we're actually providing you with a smack on the wrist because you're paying an application fee in addition to this education component. The other benefits may not be as obvious, but the court will function more smoothly because these people will be taken from their conference and not have to go into the court and see a judge. And so their case will be completely adjudicated without a court appearance for the purposes of the court. So the court night should be shorter, less judge time, less clerk time processing, all that sort of thing. In addition, these people are going to have to be taking the defensive driver class. So they will actually be supporting businesses out, not necessarily in the community of Austin, because we're not requiring that they take them here. We do have one downtown, a defensive driver outfit. But, you know, that benefit also inures to the community. So essentially, and I apologize being a little long-winded, I'm an attorney, it's one of the things they teach us. So, you know, that is sort of in broad brushes what the program will do. Again, it's something that I'm very excited about, and we are in the process of just making sure that we have proper authorization. So we're talking to the district attorney's office, who is in charge of prosecuting criminal offenses for the county. I have a deputization letter that I got from them when I was hired, which permits me to prosecute the traffic offenses in court. And so in pursuing this, it's part of that prosecutorial function, but it's still a better form to make sure that they are completely on board and have approved the program. So that's where we are. Hopefully we'll be up in a month or two. There's also some administrative things that we need to talk to the court about in terms of adjourning cases and letting them know what type of paperwork they'll be seeing with these applications and things like that. So
sounds great.
Thank you so much for your rapt attention. I was going to see how long that moment of silence lasted.
No, I think that sound, it's really exciting. It sounds great. Like you said, win-win-win. I'm just curious, do we know what percentage of those the VTLs, that the vehicle and traffic offenses that you see would be eligible, just a general feeling of
more than half. And I would think also in terms of the cases that are actually adjudicated through the court system, it would be even more, because as I said, the equipment violations are often dismissed upon proof that they fixed the condition that led to the ticket. And so those cases, those non-moving cases, are often not being sent through the court system with a fine and that sort of stuff. So in terms of the actually adjudicated offenses, it's probably much higher than that 50%.
That's really going to make a big dent, I think, in the calendar. So, and
hope
also,
so.
In addition, have a positive impact on safety in our for our drivers, young drivers, older drivers, and in between drivers.
Yeah,
All the drivers.
I mean, there are traffic offenses, and so we know they're not the most serious things that the court is handling. But I do think that, you know, every opportunity that we as a municipality have to promote rehabilitation as a component of sentencing, we're doing a service to our community, to the courts, and to society in general. So, have high hopes for it.
Thank you for bringing this program to us. I very much appreciate it, and your foresight and thoughtfulness about it, and sort of seeing what's happening outside of our little Austining here, to see how you can bring something from the outside that's working elsewhere here. And I just would like to ask any of my colleagues if you have any questions.
I have one.
Okay.
All right. I know they do this upstate. Are there any local communities that are doing this, or are we like breaking the forefront again?
I'm not aware of any local communities that are doing it. So,
So no county or state in this area, just the upstate areas that are doing it now.
Yeah, and my understanding of in the more upper state counties, all of the prosecutions are run by county district attorney's office, and so they don't necessarily have village prosecutors doing it. And so the district attorney's office is capable of sort of seeing that countywide focus, and they're present in all the courts, and that's why it's been maybe easier for them to set it up there.
Okay.
But that's a little bit of an aside as
sounds
and speculation.
Like a great book.
But yeah, I don't know any other municipalities here that are doing it.
All right, well, thanks.
I just wanted to add maybe a little bit off the beaten path with it, but pedestrians are worse than the drivers most of the time.
I don't think this fixes that.
I don't know if you ever noticed, but you can be driving down the street and you see a carriage come from between cars or a stroller.
Yeah.
And the person behind it.
They use it to block. I always think about that.
Because they're not required to have
that.
There are provisions of the vehicle and traffic law that deal with pedestrians. And so it's very rare that we get those. I will say, prior to having this position, I did not know that misuse of a white cane was actually a vehicle and traffic offense. And so that's someone who's trying to take advantage of, crossing against the light by faking blindness, maybe. But there you have it.
That's a new one.
In any event, I don't think I've had a pedestrian case yet, someone charged with crossing in between or something like that. So I'm happy to talk to the police department about any enforcement efforts they have, but.
I'm happy that you're our prosecutor. Thank you.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks much.
All right.
Thank
you very much, everybody.
Thank you so much. We really
appreciate
you taking the time out tonight to come to talk to us about this, and it sounds great. And keep us posted as to when the implementation begins.
And thanks for keeping the questions brief. I can get my kids home to bed on time.
Absolutely. Oh, they don't want to stay for the rest
of
the night.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks again. Okay. Next up, I think I'm inviting Bob Rosenblum from the Housing Action Council, who's here to address us on the important issue of foreclosure preventions. The Housing Action Council provides foreclosure prevention counseling and also advice and support to homeowners who are struggling to make ends meet throughout Westchester County. And Bob approached me at a meeting last month about making a presentation to our board and the community, and I'm pleased to welcome him here tonight.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation, Supervisor and members. Well, you took away some of my talk about what the Housing Action Council does. Do all of you know about the, I know Karen does.
Yes.
I might say, since she's obviously involved in housing issues. We try to make, we're located in Tarrytown, New York, headquartered there. We try to make increased availability of affordable housing, qualify people for that housing, and then once they're in that housing, keep them there. I am a housing counselor there. More specifically, I am a foreclosure prevention counselor. So I don't try to make more housing available, but I do try to keep people in the housing that they have already bought. Why do people come to see me? Well, they come to see me when they're having a financial crisis of one sort or another. Typically, it's a sort of thing of one of the members of the family has lost his or her job. There's been a medical issue come up, and so they are no longer able to earn the same amount of money they had earned before. Their child may have a difficulty, and therefore one of the members of the couple have had to leave work. The usual kind of things where, unfortunately, income has gone down, and so the people are facing a financial crisis. This is not, we don't typically provide our assistance for people who have signed a contract with a bank and then decided, heck, other people are getting lower rates, I should get a lower rate, and so I'd like to have a change. We help people typically who are facing a financial crisis. And the way we do that is to try to negotiate with the bank that, or the servicer, because many times the banks have sold the loan to another organization and it's being serviced by someone. But whoever it is, we try to negotiate so that the people will have a lower interest rate or they will have a longer term, and therefore make the loan more affordable than it was before, or make it more affordable given the fact that they are facing a financial crisis. So we extend the term oftentimes had been to 40 years and as low as 2%. Again, for people who are able to show this financial crisis. How do people find out about us? Well, they are referred to us by the court oftentimes. If they're in foreclosure, you can be in foreclosure after 90 days. You are then technically in default of your mortgage. The other way people find out about it is through banks. After 90 days, the banks are required by law to send a list of nonprofit organizations. And if I didn't say so before, we are a nonprofit. So the banks will send a list of nonprofits who are providing assistance to people in the community. People find out by word of mouth and also on the HUD website. So those are the ways that people find out about us. There are four agencies who do this in Westchester County. There's us, the Housing Action Council, WRO, Westchester Residential Opportunities in White Plains, Community Housing Innovations, also in White Plains, and Human Development Services of Westchester. It's important to note, and the reason I'm here, is we do what we do without cost. We don't charge individuals. We have a grant from the Attorney General's Office of the State of New York to provide our services.
Where does that money come from, that money from the Attorney General's
Attorney General's money comes from the banks who have settled because they weren't always acting in the public interest as they were supposed to. In fact, many years ago, I worked for Chase in my professional career before I now say I'm 3/5 retired. Two days a week, I work for the Housing Action Council. I'm a part-time employee, so that my former employer is paying my is paying my salary now, is what I say. Not quite that direct, but that is what's happening in some indirect fashion. So all the agencies in Westchester County, we all serve most of the Hudson Valley, not exclusively Westchester, but most of the business we get is from Westchester County. And I must tell you that quite a few of my clients have come from Ossining or the greater Ossining area. Now, the reason I specifically though asked if I might have a few words with you is that unfortunately, not everyone, not all the people who are undergoing financial crises hear about us or one of our sister agencies, but rather they're approached by, they're scammed by some unscrupulous people. And it's really to give you all a warning that these things are happening in our communities that I wanted to come speak. The New York State Attorney General's office is growing increasingly concerned about some unscrupulous attorneys, notaries, and others, oftentimes from outside New York State, who contact people who are in foreclosure. Remember that being in foreclosure is a public matter. It's on the public records. And these unscrupulous people make wildly optimistic promises of what they can accomplish and they promise this for a not insignificant fee. Typically, the scammer tells the family to stop making its mortgage payments if they're still making them, pay the scammer a hefty fee, and then in return, the scammer will practically guarantee that the family will get a modification in their mortgage that will lower their monthly payments. It's always done with a hefty upfront fee, and after that, in the best of circumstances, the scammer will fill out the paperwork and submit it with none of the required follow-through, or in the worst case, will just disappear with the money. I have innumerable numbers of clients. I've been doing this now for about 8 years. Innumerable number of clients who come to us and say, well, I just gave such and such a law firm, and they called me from California, and I've given them $5,000 to do my modification, and they didn't do anything. And I said, why did you give money to someone out in California or in Florida? And they said, well, they sent me a letter, or they called me up. Said, well, you have to be a little more careful than that. But in any case, we can help you to do this without a charge. So free help is available, and so insofar as people come to, you know, your offices, or you hear about such individuals who are in foreclosure, are afraid that they soon will be in foreclosure because they've had to stop making their mortgage payments, please send them to us, send them to one of the other agencies. I'm not here specifically necessarily to talk about the Housing Action Council, although we're happy to meet with them. But really, all of this is available without cost to individuals, paid for by the Attorney General of the State of New York through grants to our four agencies. So I have some brochures that are in Spanish and English. By the way, most of the agencies have people who speak Spanish, and I'm one of them. I spent 2 years in the Peace Corps in Bolivia, so I'm pretty fluent. Most of us have people who speak Spanish, and a number of my clients, certainly from the Austin area, prefer to speak in Spanish. So if I might leave these for
absolutely.
You, I'd be
so
delighted.
Are you all done?
I am all done.
Okay.
Insofar, unless there are questions that people may have.
Yeah, I just wanted to first just say thank you for bringing this to our attention at this public meeting. I think it's a great opportunity also for us to ask some additional questions. So I want to open it up to my colleagues if they have any questions. And I have a few.
So if somebody feels that they're in trouble and either they would like to find a company or they've been approached by a company, they're not sure, they can call the Attorney General's office to see if they're reputable or your office.
I don't think they're making, you know, the attorney. to the best of my, I'm speaking not to the best of my knowledge, the Attorney General's office does have a list of some people who they have taken, you know, who they have prosecuted, but I don't think in general they have a list of, you know,
who can help.
Who can help? I think they will tell you, though, that you should go to a not, that this service is available for free, and that they should go to one of those agencies. Now, let me point out quickly and fairly that I'm not an attorney. We can provide assistance for the first part of the foreclosure process, which is really a mediation effort. It's called a settlement conference. And so we do go to court. If it goes beyond that, the people do have to hire an attorney, or they have to get an attorney. And we then, in those instances where that's needed, we work with legal services of the Hudson Valley. I, on any number of occasions, will hand off a client, and I'll do the financial piece of it, of the application for a modification, and then to the extent they have to go to court to sit in front of a judge, which I cannot do, they will then, the person from the legal services of the Hudson Valley will handle that piece of it. And they have offices throughout the Hudson Valley.
Okay, so the agency you would go to first would be called your agency or Legal Services of the Hudson Valley?
Well, Legal Services of the Hudson Valley almost invariably, if it's if it's early on, they will send them to us. And the reason is that they prefer not to handle the gathering of all the financial data. I mean, what we are pretty good at, I have to say patting ourselves on the back maybe, is assembling the financial data that has to be submitted to the bank in order to seek a modification. Now, if a person feels that they have been somehow or another taken advantage of in signing the mortgage in some fashion or another, then we cannot help them.
You know, I'm just wondering. I just want people to be aware of who they would call for. So, Housing Action Council
or one of the other nonprofit agencies. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know the names of all of these.
You mentioned them earlier. Oh, okay. Again, if you want, which is Westchester Residential Opportunities, WRO, Community Housing Innovation, CHI,
correct.
Housing Action Council, HAC, and there's one more?
One in Port Chester. Human Development Services in
Port
Chester.
Human Development Services of Westchester.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're probably the closest one, but I mean, White Plains is not that far away.
Okay, great.
We all do. Yeah. And in all cases, they shouldn't just drop in. They should make a call and make an appointment.
Great. Are there other questions? I have some. First statement.
What's your name?
Bob Rosenblum.
Thanks. And I just wanted to ask a couple of questions. I had an opportunity to work sometimes with people who were not so successful, and I wanted to know when I was working for Sandy Galef, and I wanted to know how it's been going, because we would get a lot of people who would be in the process of thinking that they were going to be able to renegotiate with the bank, and the bank would just drag along, make all these excuses, say they'd never gotten the documents, and it would be months and months and months till they get a modification.
I'm afraid it takes a lot of patience to wind these things through a bank system. They have a huge bureaucracy. And one of the things, though, that we are fairly good at doing is showing the bank this really is the person's income. Proved it, and because a lot of times people won't realize what they have to. If people do it, make the application on their own, they won't realize what the bank requires in terms of proof. You can have on a piece of paper that I earn X number of dollars a month, but you then have to show it into your bank account. You have to be able to show it in terms of your pay stub. So we know the kinds of things that have to be gathered. But all that having been said, it can be a long and sometimes aggravating process. And what I think we at least do is, some of what I do is act as a psychological counselor and say, don't worry, we're still submitting things. This is not unusual. Some people just give up or they get so frustrated. And part of my job is to say, this always takes a long time, and we're going to see you through. Whether you get a modification or not, I cannot promise. But what I can promise is that you'll get an answer that we will understand, and that if it's not a fair answer, that we will then pursue it to higher up in the bank. We will lift it to higher levels. I would have finally, you know, also say that the banks have gotten better.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of my question.
Many of the calls we used to make to the 800 numbers would be routed to a foreign person in, you know, operating in a foreign country. That person would not really understand the mortgage process and would be reading from a screen, and quite obviously. I think some of these problems have been dealt with now, and that they are better at least looking at these things in a more expeditious fashion than they had been. But it's still more frustrating than one would like.
I mean, one of the other things, you said it's frustrating, but I just remember that, again, documents would be submitted multiple times, and the banks would claim they never got them. And, you know, they'd fax them a million times.
One of the things we've stopped, one of the things that that has reformed more recently is that much of the materials we now send is through an email attachment. And so we scan it, email it, and then we have the email address, and it's pretty clear that everything is in there. With faxes, this page got lost, that page got lost, it never really made it through. Well, I have the proof here. I mean, you know, I have the receipt. Well, we never got it. That is pretty well going. Now, with regard, the other thing that's happened is that particularly on a foreclosure action where we are in court with a officer of the court. Remember, I'm not in front of a judge. I am with a referee who was appointed by a judge. But at those settlement conferences that I attend with my clients, the referee tells me that I am to send things to the attorney who is representing the bank, the plaintiff, the bank. And in that case, I always am ordered to submit the documents to the law firm, and almost always by email attachment or attachment to an email.
Okay.
So then the bank, the new procedure is that the bank then is, the law firm is then responsible for getting it to their client. And so there can be no excuse that the paperwork didn't get to them. As long as I've met my deadline, the paperwork got to them, the person might be turned down, but nonetheless, it can't be turned down because, hey, you didn't meet the deadline for getting all the paperwork in.
Two more questions. I'm just going to throw them both out. One is, legal services of the Hudson Valley also was extremely overburdened and seemed like they couldn't even keep up with the caseload that was out there. Is that still the case, or do they have more? But before you answer that, let me just ask the second question so you can take them both, which is that answer that question.
Legal services of the Hudson Valley for a while had closed shop entirely with regards to taking on new clients in the real estate area.
Right.
They subsequently, as I understand it, got a grant, and they are back in business in a very substantial way. But they want to represent people who have a legal issue before the courts that is, I don't know, as a non-lawyer, is legal in nature as opposed to financial in nature. If the people have stopped making their mortgage payments because one of the members of the family has lost his or her job and they can't afford it anymore, that would be not something that they would be interested in. They would refer to us. If, on the other hand, it's gone beyond that and we've submitted paperwork wherein we show that the person could afford a modified loan and is still being foreclosed on, they would then take it over from us. So I think what we've done is work out where they have less of the work than they used to have on any particular case, and more of it goes to us or to any of the other nonprofits. They are, in short, back in business. I certainly deal with them on, you know, all day long during the 2 days a week that I'm there.
And the last question, you referred to these unscrupulous law firms that were.
There are a few.
Okay, but the thing that you had said was that they tell them to stop paying their mortgage. I seem to recall that was also something that at some point you were told you have to do. You have to stop paying your mortgage so that you could go into foreclosure, so that you could get a loan modification. Not true or true?
It's both true. No, it's both true. It used to be that that's what even people at the banks told people, this was back in 2008, 2009 when I first started doing this, that you were told that you want a modification, but you're still paying, then you can afford the loan that you've gotten, stop making payments, and then submit a modification. And after 90 days, when you are technically, legally in default of your loan, you will then be provided an opportunity to get a modification. And I think on those instructions, we initially, back in 2008, told people to do that. We have subsequently learned, and it's become standard practice, that you never stop making payments if you can help it. That you show a need for a modification by showing that you're struggling and you really cannot afford it.
Show it by the documents that you provide that shows what the income is.
Right.
Never by, they don't do that. If they did that before, as you said, they don't do that anymore.
Okay. No banks. There are a few services who are still kind of encouraging that, but it's almost never done, and it's never the right thing to do.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank
you. Appreciate the time.
You're
and
welcome.
All the information.
Thanks, Bob.
Okay. So finally, I would like to invite up Mr. Bob Fritchie, who had contacted my office some weeks ago to schedule a chance to address the board. And ask for support on a very important issue that affects our volunteer firefighters. The board has been provided with some background information and a sample resolution of support, and we look forward to hearing how we may be able to help.
Well, good evening, Supervisor Levenberg and council members. Some of you know me, and for those who don't, I'll just give you a brief history of myself. I'm a proud member of the Austining Fire Department since 1979. I am representing right now as second vice president, Westchester County Volunteer Firemen's Association. I also am the vice president of Westchester County for Hudson Valley. So I'm here in a couple different hats. But basically, this is statewide. What you have in front of you is the first page. Basically, FASNY, who's the Firemen's Association of the State of New York, we have a legislative session in November. What happens is all throughout the whole state, everybody gets together in their different districts or regions, and they come with ideas, what they'd like to see on the bill or as a bill. So last year, just to give you a little history, the expanded cancer coverage bill was number one on our scorecard, again, passed the Senate, and it failed in the Assembly. So it's failing on the local level. This is why, as members of FASNY, members of the county, we're out looking for support from the local level, because basically what I'm saying is career firefighters, City of White Plains, your career guys, they have this coverage and the volunteers don't. So basically we're being discriminated against because we fight the same fires that they do. So
you just want to walk us through the resolution a little bit?
Yeah, well, I can, the resolution, do you want me to read it or you want me
just generalize for anybody who's watching and doesn't, and just, this is about the fact that there can't, it's not, you're looking for legislation that would cover,
right,
expanded cancer coverage for firefighters.
Volunteer firefighters.
Yeah, but what's the expanded cancer part of it?
Well, basically, I think what that is if you have benefits, your benefits will pay for all or
different types of cancer. What's being excluded that you're not getting now?
We're not getting anything.
Okay.
We don't get anything. We don't get any type of cancer coverage through the state as a volunteer firefighter. If you have benefits, you can use your benefits.
I see.
But for those people that don't have benefits or as a secondary benefit to cover this, This bill would cover your cancer care.
So, just the beginning of the resolution says that it's to memorialize a resolution compelling the Assembly and the Governor to pass the cancer presumptive bill, which would extend the already existing volunteer firefighters benefit law to cover all instances of melanoma as well as cancers of the digestive, hematological, lymphatic, urinary, prostate, neurological, breast, and reproductive. reproductive systems. So those are, I guess, the ones that are, I mean, it does sound like all, but there is the firefighters benefit law.
Right, the VFBL. Right. And that's again, it's a basic coverage. It's just like I go to a fire now, I'm covered. And it just, it gets to a certain point and then it doesn't cover us when it gets into the cancer end of the.
I see. So you have this volunteer firefighter benefit law that only covers a certain portion.
Correct.
But then it doesn't cover the cancer portion.
Correct.
Okay. And so this is basically to expand that.
Right.
Got it.
And it's, again, it's stalling at the local level because it's a money issue. And it's a sticky point because it gets down to, I just have something on here. I just want to.
That's the thing I'm not 100% sure that I understand is where is the money coming from to bet for this, the firefighters' benefit? Is that coming from somehow through our taxes locally or is it a state?
Well, we're self-insured. So that, you know, as far as that part of it, I don't know. I don't have that answer for.
We have to find out where is it.
Yeah, I mean, I think we maybe just need, I don't actually think we got a copy of the legislation. I think if we could get a copy of that volunteer firefighters benefit law, just so we have a better understanding.
I could provide that.
The impact is, because you're saying you need local support, so we should have a better understanding of what the impact is at the local level.
Sure, I could provide that for you.
Okay.
Just, again, like I say, it becomes, at the local level, I think it's failing because of it's a money impact on the municipalities. And I think that's where it's failing.
Oh, so it is the municipality that has to cover it?
Yes. Okay. So just to give you a little tidbit, you know, currently volunteer firefighters save New York taxpayers $3.12 billion, I said billion, in salaries and benefits alone. An additional 30,822 career firefighters would be necessary to go to an all-paid service in the state. The annual cost of an all-career service would be $3.87 billion. In addition, there would be a one-time cost of $5.95 billion to acquire existing stations, structures, vehicles, and equipment.
This is for what, though? For the state of New York?
State of New York.
Okay. The complete state of
New York. Right. State of New York.
Okay. So where are all these numbers coming from?
This is from FASD.
So obviously we know we have a fantastic volunteer fire department here in Ossining, and we benefit from it greatly. I think I'm guessing that all of us understand how important it is to our safety and to our ability to sleep soundly at night. So, you know, we appreciate everything that our volunteers do for us here. I just want to make sure that that's really, really clear.
I just think that we have to take a look
just,
at what
yeah,
the
we
money
just want to know what the details are.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, this is groundwork, you know, to get things going, to stoke the fire a little bit.
Absolutely.
And, you know, bring it to your attention because
no
I don't think
intended.
It. Yeah, right. I don't think it's reached down to this level.
Right.
And I think that's why it's not getting through. And there's going to be people for us, people against it. We get it. But, you know, if we don't stoke the fire, you know, we can't complain later when we're back next year and trying to get it number one on our bill again.
Okay. I mean, I'm just going to say maybe you don't want to stay away from that term, but otherwise I think you're good.
I think we can handle it, though.
Okay, I'm sure you can.
Just a couple little another thing. Yeah, approximately 1,300 stations would have to be built or new or reconstructed.
Again, this is we're talking about statewide, right?
Statewide, yes. Yeah. And property taxes would rise 3.3% and 123% with an average of 26.5%. And as a result of increasing the number of volunteers, average response time was reduced by 2.5%. So, you know, it's just, I sent you the video. I don't know if you watched it. You know, I don't know. Can I show the video?
Can you show it now?
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
I appreciate it.
See the video.
It's on this, so you should be able to see it pretty good.
Oh, yeah. I don't see enough videos.
Yeah. But you don't have it on a USB, right? You just have it on the. It's just downloaded on the. It's just downloaded.
to see it pretty good, though.
Okay. Well, the only thing is our viewers.
We have to put it on. We have to put it for the public.
How long is it?
15 minutes.
Oh, yeah, no. We're not going to be able to do that. What we could do is like, yeah, what we do is, let's, if you forward it to me again, because I don't remember seeing the link, and if I did.
Yeah, I
don't remember. In any case, if you want to just send it again.
Okay.
I'll circulate it to the board members, and then we'll post it also on the website as part of the work session. Okay?
Sure.
And then we, once we get a little bit more information, we'll have an opportunity to talk about it at another work session.
Absolutely.
And just see if we can, you know, come up with some.
All right, great.
What we want to do.
Thank you. I appreciate your time.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We appreciate your time and all that you do for our community. Okay. I had one quick announcement that I had neglected. I just want to throw out there, and then I think we're almost done. This April 8th, I forgot to mention that there's going to be a centennial remembrance, which is organized on behalf of the Central Committee of Organized War Veterans of the Town of Ossining. On Saturday, April 8th, they will hold a special 100th anniversary of the Declaration of War that brought the United States into World War I, April 6, 1917, and the death of an Ossining son, Edmund Charles Clinton Janay, which was on April 16, 1917. The program will start at 11 a.m. in Nelson Park at the War Memorials. Please join a simple tribute to the local men who served and died in the war to end all wars. Additionally, they will remember Edmund Charles Clinton Janay, who was the first American to be killed in combat after the United States entered the war. It is their devotion to duty that has made our nation what it is today and what it will continue to be. And that is it. So, let's see. Do I have anything else? Are we done? We are done with our work session, and I would ask for a motion to go into executive session for legal counsel. Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstention. Okay, thank you so much, everybody, and we look forward to seeing you next Wednesday. We are a special Wednesday night because of Passover, Monday night and Tuesday night, and we wish everybody a happy Passover, and is there anything else that our offices, that's next week, they're going to be closed? We'll be at the courthouse on Wednesday at 7:30 p.m., and we'll have more information for you soon about that meeting.